Jai Jinendra, one and all. On behalf of the Department of Jainology, University of Madras, and SSS Jain College, Teenagar, Research Foundation for Jainology, Jain Study Group on Facebook, and Jain Heritage Centers, Bangalore, I extend a warm welcome to one and all. Before I formally welcome you all, we'll have the Mangalacharan in the form of meditation on Namokkara Mahamantra, followed by the Darshana Stuti. So I request you all to sit in Jnana Mudra. Choose your mudra. You will sit with your spine straight. Deep breathing. Concentrate on your breath. Experience the Jina in you. Experience that you are a Jina. With all the energy flowing from the cosmos, concentrate on your breath, on the Gyata Drishta Bhav, the supreme Chetana that resides in every living being. Deep inhaling. Namo Arihantanam. Inhale. Namo Siddhanam. Inhale. Namo Ayariyanam. Inhale. Namo Uvajayanam. Inhale. Namo Loe Savasahunam. Inhale. Eso Panchanamokkaro. Inhale. Savapavapanasano. Inhale. Mangalanam cha savvesim. Inhale. Padamam havai mangalam. One last time. Over to Ravichandran sir for the Darshan Stuti.
Darshanam Deva Devasya. Darshanam Papanashanam. Darshanam Swargasopanam. Darshanam Moksha Sadhanam. Darshanena Jinendranam. Sadhunam Andanena Cha. Nachiram Tishtate Papam. Chitrahaste Yatodakam. Vitaraghamukam Drashtva. Padmaraga Samaprabham. Naika Janma Kritam Papam. Darshanena Vinashati. Darshanam Jina Suryasya. Samsara Dvantarashanam. Bodhanam Chitta Padmasya. Samastata Prakashanam. Darshanam Jina Chandrasya. Saddharma Mruta Varshanam. Janma Daha Vinashaya. Vardhanam Sukhavaridhe. Jivadikatvam Pratidarshakaya. Samyatvamukhyashtagunashrayaya. Prashantarupaya Digambaraya. Devadhidevaya Namojinaya. Chidanandaikarupaya. Jinaya Paramatmane. Paramatma Prakashaya. Nityam Siddhatmane Namaha. Anantananta Samsara. Santati Cheda Karanam. Jinaraja Padamboja. Smaranam Sharanam Mama. अन्यता शरणं नास्ति त्वमेव शरणं मम तस्मात् कारुण्य भावेन रक्ष रक्षा जिनेश्वर नहि त्राता नहि त्राता नहि त्राता जगत्त्रये वीतरागात् परो देवो न भूतो न भविष्यति जिनेर्भक्ति जिनेर्भक्ति जिनेर्भक्तिर्दिने दिने सदा मेस्तु सदा मेस्तु सदा मेस्तु भवे भवे जन्म जन्माकृतं पापं जन्म कोटि समार्जितं जन्म मृत्युर्जरा मूलं अन्यते चिन दर्शना अन्यते चिन वंदना।
Thank you, Ravichandran sir, for the beautiful Darshan Stuti. Again, on behalf of the five organizations that I just mentioned, I extend a warm welcome to one and all, especially to our guest of honor today, Shri Nirmal Kumarji Sethi, who has joined us from New Delhi and who works internationally to preserve the Jain heritages. So I would like to request Namrata Jain to introduce the guest of honor today to us.
Jai Jainendra. So today we have Shri Nirmal Kumar Jain Sethi ji, and he has been awarded Shravak Ratna Muni by Swasti Shri Charu Kirti Bhattarak Mahaswami in 2006. And how do I start about him? He has been the president of All India Digambar Association from a lot of places like Lucknow in 1998, New Delhi in 2004, and Kundalpur Vaishali Tirth Kameti from Bihar, and a lot more places. Nirmal Kumarji has been the trustee of All India Digambar Association since 1988. And has rendered various services to the Digambar Association. And he has been working for Jainism at the international level also by having study tours globally. Many books and periodicals have been published on religious, archaeological, and education by him. I would, because of the time constraint, I would just like to say one thing, that we have a beautiful and an very, very hardworking soul with us he's going to inaugurate today's special edition online lecture on lecture series on Jain heritage, and which will be aired on various online platforms. So over to you, ma'am. Priya ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you, Namrata. Welcome, Nirmal Kumar ji. It's a proud privilege to have you as the first guest of honor for the first lecture series that commences today for 7 days. I would like to welcome Shri Nitin HP from Bangalore, who has devoted so much of his life in audiographing, in videographing, in photographing the heritage that you see in Karnataka and in so many places. So he's the right person to deliver the first lecture. And we welcome HP, Nitin sir. I request Namrata Jain to introduce Nitin HP.
Thank you, Priya ma'am. And when I was given Nitin sir's biodata, his profile, and I was like, how can any IT genius, how can anybody be juggling his life between corporate life and his passion towards Jainism, working for Jainism in all possible ways? So when I was reading his profile, I got to know that he is an IT genius. He's been working there for almost 14 years now. And he has led the Guinness World Record by taking the initiative of world's largest photo sculpture for Accenture company. And he leads a team of IT professionals that manage corporate websites, search engine optimization, data privacy, and a lot more. So he is an IT genius. And but his passion lies in Jainism. When I read his profile, I knew that that is because he has authored many research articles on Karnataka's Jain heritage and on conservation of Jain heritage nationally. He has contributed images to the first book on Jainism in Slovakian language for master thesis on Jainism. And he presented to the Freie University in Berlin. So not just nationally, but internationally, he's been working on recognizing, on making Jainism being recognized everywhere. And he has been an ardent activist in saving our heritage during the attack on the Digambar Muni in Tamil Nadu in the year 2004, the Girnar attack in 2013, and the Sallekhna moment in 2016. And I mean, he is a marvelous person. He has multiple awards and accolades like Adarsh Jain Yuva Award, National Photography Award, Jain Achiever Award, just to name a few. So I welcome Sri Nitin HPG. Jai Jinendra. Over to you, Priya ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you, Namrita. Thank you. Welcome, Nitin sir. On behalf of the five organizations, that is the Departments of Jainology, Research Foundation, and JSG Group, and of course, on behalf of Nitin again, I extend a warm welcome to the entire audience, to our chief guests and everybody. I would like to request Sri Krishna Chansa Choradia, who is the General Secretary of Research Foundation for Jainology, to come and give his inaugural address. And he'll welcome on behalf of everybody. Kishan Chansa, can we have you here with us? Kishan Chansa, are you there, sir? Kishan Chansa?
He was there. He joined. Yeah,
he was there. Can you just...
Yes, I am available.
Can you spotlight him?
I am available. Can you hear?
Please give your address, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir. Everybody present here in today's August function, our guest of honor, respected Sri Nirmal Kumarji Sethi Saab, or Nitin Saab, who is going to give a lecture today, and other audience who have joined this group, it gives me immense pleasure in welcoming one and all of you present here. I remember last year with R.P. Jain, I met Sri Nirmal Kumarji Sethi Artist Residence, and I was motivated by his experience by saying that the heritage should be preserved and a new construction and new temples which are coming up should be separately done, but the heritage should not be disturbed. So I remember those words today, and with that basic idea that we should preserve the heritage, which is our history of Jainism for several thousands of years, it should be preserved, and our efforts on this heritage movement propagation, it should be very successful if we all together join hands and see that our every sect of Jain society is on the same line to promote and preserve our heritage. I welcome one and all of you wholeheartedly. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kishan Chansa. Very briefly, I'll tell you about the idea behind the whole lecture series. Very briefly, I won't take much time because we have so many visuals to be rolled by the specialists. We have to hear Nirmal Kumar sir. So Jai Bharat, Jai Jin Shasan is an initiative to integrate the Shramanic and the various yogic cultures and make Bharat Varsh a Vishwa Guru. This is an initiative to integrate the East and the West, the North and the South, breaking barriers of language, sectarian divides, the pseudo customs that are followed in the name of religion. This initiative recently completed a 17-day e-Paryushan and Das Lakshan celebration this month on Zoom, which was also live streamed on YouTube. This was done in two languages and was viewed by at least 2,000 people. It strengthened the spirit of spirituality and unity in diversity. Now the Department of Jainology, the University of Madras, along with four other organizations whose names are given in the WhatsApp messages and the flyers, jointly present a 7-day special lecture series with PowerPoint presentations by experts on Jain heritage spread over different states of India. The staff and students of both departments of Jainology at the University of Madras and Shasan Jain College and the Research Foundation and the JSG and Jain Heritage Centers are committed, totally committed to promoting Jain philosophy in the global era effectively. The department is blessed by many Guru Bhagwans, as two Sadhvijis are currently doing MPhil and PhD in the department. Nearly 2,000 students from different backgrounds of defense, cyber forensics, journalism, mass communication, psychology, Christian studies, etc., have imbibed the philosophy of Bhagwan Mahavir through core, elective, and soft skill papers offered at the Department of Jainology. The department has produced more than 150 masters, 30 MPhils, and 15 PhDs in the past 35 years. Likewise, the departments of genealogy at Shasan Jain College has been imparting PG diploma programs in the field of genealogy for the past 12 years. Also, the Jain Study Group on Facebook and Jain Heritage Center's website and Facebook are serving academic interests and promoting Jainism in the global era very, very effectively. We have Shri Dilip sir, who is the founder of the Jain Study Group, and Mittal Lalan, who manages the Jain Study Group. And we have Nitin, who manages the Jain Heritage Centers, his beautiful website. I'll talk more about it a little later. So these sessions, the PowerPoint sessions that we are going to have over 7 days, will cover the Jain Heritage Centers of Karnataka, the first day and the last day. And tomorrow we'll have the Jain Heritage Centers of Devgarh. And then day after we'll have of Khajuraho. And the presenter, Shri Shanti Swarup Sinhaji, has joined us today. So I welcome him also. And then we'll have the Jain Centers of Tamil Nadu, followed by the Jain Centers of Orissa, West Bengal, and then finally we'll have the Karnataka. So it will be a visual treat for your senses and for your soul. So a lot of thought has to go in. We need to bring in all the heritage centers and of Northeast, of Rajasthan, of Maharashtra. So we plan to do all these things at the next level, provided you all support this movement and spread the awareness. We want this presentation to be viewed by the children. The children should take pride in being a Jain. We want the youngsters, we want the children to involve themselves in preserving the Jain heritages. So our strength, our inspiration to do this lecture series comes from people like Nirmal Kumarji Sethi, who is preserving the Jain Heritage Centers internationally. It comes from photographers like Nitin and Shanti Swarup Sinhaji, Kanak Ajitdas sir, Ravichandran sir, and the Ahimsa Walk people. Our inspiration comes from them to conduct this lecture series. Our inspiration comes from the students who study in the Department of Jainology, and we take these students for these trips. So we have taken our students for the field trips to Karnataka, to Madhya Pradesh, to Kerala, to Karnataka, and to Tamil Nadu. So our strength to conduct these this special lecture series comes from the student force, and this is an extension, an academic activity for the student community, and we are so privileged to share this lecture series with the audience with the help of the technology in this time of the pandemic. So इस पैंडेमिक में जहां मृत्यु नाच रही है और जीवन रो रहा है, जिनेश्वर भगवंतों ने जो जिनवाणी सिर्फ बताई नहीं है, सिर्फ जिए हैं. The jinas, they experience, they practice the Jainism, and because of that philosophy, our acharyas wrote thousands of books, and our sculptors engraved the images, the sculptors which we are going to see. So 2000 years of Indian history, we see that India has been attacked by so many dynasties, whether it is the Lodis, Tughlaqs, Mughals, the Sultanates, etc. But never India has gone and attacked any other land. So that is the Ahimsa culture. And Bhagwan Mahavir said that there can be one weapon better than the other weapon, but the weapon of non-violence is supreme. And the world needs non-violence today, the philosophy preached by the Jinas, which is preserved in our heritages. Heritage centers. So we need to promote these heritage centers in order to promote the philosophy of Bhagwan. So our strength comes from the 5 organizations joining us in promoting this lecture series. So I welcome one and all. And now I would request Shri Nirmal sir to deliver his address. Over to Nirmal Kumarji Sethi. I request you to kindly unmute yourself, sir. Yes, sir.
Respected Priyadarshna ji. Dr. Churiyaji, my brother Nitin, and all our Sinhaji is also here, and many people, Rajmal Jain is also, many people are there. To all them, Jai Jinendra. And on this Chamamani day, we want also Chamamani. 1 minute. I want to tell you that in Karnataka, I am doing this work of preservation since 1981. Karnataka and your Tamil Nadu and your Kerala, all these places. And our Nitin is cooperating with us from last 15 years. and he has acquired great knowledge about this antiques, and he is also helped us in organizing one exhibition in 2018 in Son Belgola that was visited by more than 2 lakh people, and that was very it was very fine exhibition. You see that we have also renovated in old Karnataka areas more than 100 temples which are old, might be 1500 years old or 1000 years old, like that. So this work we are doing Kerala, in Karnataka, this is a lot of ancient things are there. What I want to tell you to all these people that this documentation has not been done by Government of India so far. The documentation was started by the British people and left uncared for so far. You saw in about 12 years back, maybe 20 years, 18 years back, I went to...
Nirmal sir, आपका वीडियो नहीं आ रहा है.
नहीं आ रहा है.
हाँ, अभी अभी आ रहा है. बीच में बहुत गड़बड़ था.
अच्छा,
अब ठीक है सर.
हाँ, so the planning commission, I went to planning commission. I told them that in this Bhagwan Mahavir birthday 2600 birthday, please allot about 1500 crores of money for renovation. Then they asked me that they can allot 2000 crores, no problem. But the Department of Archaeology should give them the demand. When I went to the archaeologist, they said we cannot give demand because there is no documentation. So the main problem of our antiques, particularly Jain antiques, is this, that documentation has not been done. So we must press Government of India for doing documentation. Number two, you have seen that research work is being done in Buddhism, research work is doing in Sikhism and in other, all these people. There is, but have you ever heard that Government of India or any state government has established a research institute for Jainism? Today you see, Jainism is the most ancient religion of the world. It's no doubt. Nobody can challenge it. But nobody has taken care doing research. That is why when I tried everything, left no stone unturned, then I thought, let us, we do ourselves the work of seeing the world countries. So we from Mahasabha decided to visit 40 countries of the world, and 8 countries we have visited. You know, in Sri Lanka, when we went first, we had a seminar with your university there. They have told me, and there is a proof that Tirthankar Neminath went there, and the name of this hill is a Avaikiriya. That means Neminath has saved the animals while he went for marriage in and he did not marry. But you see, he माने जानवरों को बचाया उन्होंने. तो मेरा कहने का मतलब है कि जो तीर्थंकर नेमिनाथ का जो 22nd तीर्थंकर है, there is a proof that he went to Sri Lanka. Similarly, we went to Ethiopia. In Ethiopia, you see, we have seen 3 temples excavated by Germans. And in every temple, I've seen that there is a Siddhisila. And in Siddhisila, there is inscriptions. And those inscriptions have been read by Delhi University professor, Mr. R.K. Vasisht. He says that inscription is 1300 BC. So 1300 BC inscription found in excavation by Germans, and that is Siddhisila, is our Jain Siddhisila. So you see that shows that 3,300 years old, there are 3 temples we found in Ethiopia. Similarly, in the same thing is Kenya. And now we went to Greece, the same thing we found in Greece, that there is a samadhi of Kalyan Muni there, is still there. And your museum, they are showing the naked murtis there. That shows that the Nirgantha tradition was there in Greece long ago, maybe 2,000, 3,000 years ago, like that. Similar thing, we went to now South America. You know the South America, Peru, Guatemala, and Mexico. In Mexico, in museum, we found two Kayasar Pratima. They say that they have found these Pratimas in 2600 BC site. That shows they're so old in your Mexico, the excavation, they got the Tirthankar images there. Same thing in Peru, when we, you know, in your Guatemala, we went there, we found the Murti, Sina Sahib ko bataunga, unhone Devgad ke baare mein bol rahe hain. Devgad mein jo Bhagwan ka jo Upajaya ki Murti hai, same Murti we found in Guatemala, in the museum there. They said that this found from the Tikal site, which is 2600 BC old. So what I'm telling you, in the world, there is great scope for doing research on Jainism, and we should request government of India to have established one, your research center, big research center in India, to go this type of research work all over the world. We are now visiting 32 countries more and planning there, but due to Corona, all the things has been delayed. So far, Mr. Nitin is concerned, he is a great, dedicated for Jainism, ancient things, and he takes our Hampana Nagaraja as his guru. And Hampanaji, you know that he is a great scholar on Jainism and all these antiquities. We cannot question his knowledge. So our Nitin is doing under his guidance many things, for which we must thanks Mr. Nitin. And you see, whatever I am telling you, that the government of India, we put a question in parliament now a few months ago. Reply of government of India was that they have not done anything about Jainism. They have done many things for Buddhism. They have done many things. I am telling you, we have seen a site, I know more earlier, Sravasti. Sravasti, they have developed the Buddhism site. And so a lot of Buddhist people are coming there. But so far the Jain site is concerned, because Tirthankar, third Tirthankar, Sambhavnath. Sravasti is the birthplace of Tirthankar, Sambhavnath. So Sambhavnath, that place is so old, but they have not developed anything. Whatever the images they got there, that they have taken it to Lucknow. The British people has taken Lucknow. So that is lying in Lucknow. They do not want to develop the Sravasti site, so from the Jain angle. So what I'm telling you, the government of India's state motherly treatment should be stopped. We should request them that you should do justice to Jainism, and research work should be done. And particularly, I'm telling Mr. Sinha, documentation work is not done very well. So that documentation work should be done. And I'm telling you that the protected monument, which the government of India, ASI department has got there with them, they are not doing justice with those also. They are having those things with them, but not doing any justice to them. That is, I am telling you. So what today I am telling you, that you are on Karnataka, you are doing this very good speech. Will we give more light to the things, and to all those people who are interested in history, archaeology, I request them that we must press government of India for establishing a research center for Jainism. And another thing, the documentation should be done. Third, that whatever the monuments which they have got, they should do protect them. Fourth thing, inscription. You have got in India so much inscription that are also not deciphered properly. But in the world, there are inscriptions. In Ethiopia, there is inscription. There is a Peru, there are inscriptions, but nobody is trying to see them and decipher them. If we decipher them, then we'll get great knowledge about our history, and for which we will be proud of. So, Sudarshan Priyadarshanaji, I thank you very much for organizing this thing and for inviting me for doing this thing. I am very glad for this. I thank you very much. And for the Madras Institute, we always we will always try to cooperate with you. And if you give me 3 or 4 residents who want to study Jainism or archaeology in your university, we will give them a scholarship also. This much I can tell you. And thank you very much. All the people who are listening to me, I thank you very much. And we should do justice to Jain architecture, archaeology things, and inscriptions and all other things. Thank you very much.
बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद निर्मल कुमार साहब, सेठी साहब आपका, कि आपने हमारे एक फोन से हमारे इनविटेशन को एक्सेप्ट किया और आपने हमारा मार्गदर्शन किया कि क्या करना है. सो नो डाउट सर, द गवर्नमेंट इज डूइंग द आई मीन व्हाट टू से स्टेप मदरली ट्रीटमेंट इज बेस्टोड ऑन जैनिज्म. सो कलेक्टिवली वी ऑल हैव टू डू. सो वी लुक अप ऑन यू फॉर गाइडेंस एंड द डिपार्टमेंट स्टैंड्स विद यू एंड आई थिंक ऑल द 5 ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस are with you in promoting the guidelines that you have just given. Thank you for setting the stage. And now we look forward to Nitin, who is going to share with us the rich heritage. I would like to tell you, it was through the eyes of Nitin that we saw Karnataka. I have taken my department students twice or thrice, and we have gone to all those places suggested by Nitin, from Shravangalgola to Kundadri to Venur to Jerusappa. So he's the right person to tell us about Karnataka. So welcome, Nitin, and over to Nitin. So we'll all listen to him, and you all will note down the questions. At the end of the session, we'll be asking 3 questions to the audience members. Whoever answers will get a big round of applause. That is what we can give you during this time of pandemic. So over to Nitin, and I request Ravichandran sir to help him.
Nitin can unmute.
Let me know. I'll just start sharing my screen. Let me know once you are able to see my screen, then I'll start off with the session.
Yes, we can see you, Nitin. You can go ahead. Nitin, please go ahead, Nitin.
So I hope I'm audible, and also these slides are visible to everyone.
Yes, Nitin.
Okay.
Yes, Nitin.
Jai Jinendra, everyone. And I would like to thank the Department of Jainology, the Jainology Research Foundation, the Shasan College, and the Jain Study Group, and as well as the other organizations who are involved, for giving me an opportunity to be a speaker on this esteemed lecture series. And so before we start, I think like Priyadarshana madam mentioned, yes, the heritage of Karnataka is definitely very rich. Having said that, when it comes to the Jain heritages of Karnataka, there are very, very standard known set of names of places which everyone looks up to. So our intent over here is to definitely look at them, and as well as look at some of the rich legacy that we have, that our forefathers and our acharyas and our royal dynasties have laid the path for the rich Jain heritage of Karnataka. Now, as we move on, so let me just quickly give you a quick snapshot of the different kind of slides that you will see over here. So you will see 2 sessions of mine. One is today and the other one is on the last day. So here we will mainly look into the basic, how did the Jain heritage grow in Karnataka? Then we look at 5 or 6 districts, some of the important sites or temples in Karnataka. Then the rest of the things will come up in the second session. And so before we start, friends, so one specific thing what I would like to say is Jain heritage. Heritage means heritage doesn't go alone. Heritage and history walk together is what I believe in, and that is what has been the legacy that we have seen. So having said that, what I thought is it is always imminent to first have a big brief description of how the history has grown over the years, and how the what are the historical references in terms of those references, in terms of the growth of Jain heritage in Karnataka, which will definitely be used in some or the other way during the successive slides. And now moving on to the next slide. So before we start, you know, like this is something like when I start working on when I started looking into the entire way of presenting, I was looking at how do I present it? Should I present it based on geography, based on dynasties, based on different time frames, that is the centuries, or should I go based on different concepts? So that's when I thought it's a bit of a fix for any presenter when he or she tries to present things about the heritage of a particular region, that too particularly a vast state such as Karnataka. So that is why I thought it is imminent to just have a quick snapshot of this. Whenever you want to come back, you just keep this as a reference whenever I'm speaking, because that is where your entire story would revolve around. And it might go from the northmost part of Karnataka to the southernmost, out of the coastal part, or the western or the central part, anywhere. That's how the entire history is knitted over different time frames. Now, moving on. So like I said, it is all closely knitted. Say, for example, the Karnataka's Jain history have been, the inscriptions have laid the path for the Jain history and heritage of Karnataka. Along with that, we find the ascetics tradition that have grown over the centuries since the 3rd century BC, and the royal patronage, by the royals families, and as well as the patronage by business class and common men. And of course, the temples based on various Jain concepts. That's how the entire history and the heritage of Karnataka is being knitted together. Now, moving on, when it comes to the inscriptions, like I mentioned, inscriptions and the manuscripts are the best sources of recorded history. Like Nirmalji said, yes, documentation and research play a very important role in the preservation of any religion and propagation of its heritage and antiquity to the posterity, to the upcoming generations. When it comes to the inscriptions of Karnataka, like you see on the screen, there are over 2000 published inscriptions that are spread across Karnataka. There might be even more. That is the minimum number, out of which around 1800 inscriptions have been published in the Jaina Shasana Samputa that has been published by the Kannada University Hampi. This is a vision of our Charukirti Bhattarak Swamiji and our Hampana ji, who is the honorary editor over there, and Professor Devarkonda Reddy sir and his team went through this. It has been published in 3 different languages. It's just come out in Kannada with all the 5 volumes, and the Hindi volumes are under print, and same with the English volumes. Those are our major sources for our entire inscriptional studies. And we have inscriptions from the 5th century onwards. And we have oldest references from the 5th century, of course, but it does mention about instances from 3rd century BC onwards. And again, like I mentioned in the beginning of the slide, inscriptions are also called as Shasanas. And how are they classified as? They could be a Nishadi or a Salekana memorial, could be a Pada Shasana, a Kamba Shasana, something in the form of a pillar. It might contain details such as details of temples, Manastambas or the Brahmastambas, details of rituals that are performed in a temple. Some of the terminologies, I will tell you the reason I'm telling you about the rituals, they also form a part of our heritage. Some of the terminologies that have been used that really, like, we are just mesmerized over there. Something like, what do you say? Something like a Kshira Abhishek is called as a Haludare Abhisheka. The terminologies that are used those days, and how have they grown over the centuries? That is again a part of our heritage. These are all these details. And again, the Dana or Dattis, that is the donations of lands and other things that have been given to different sections for the maintaining the puja and performing the day-to-day operations of a temple. And then details of the ascetic order. We will, and then moving on, like I mentioned, there are over 2000 inscriptions, and close to 1800 inscriptions have been documented in different parts of have been found in different parts of India, and they've all been documented. If you look at this, I mean, I deliberately wanted to give you this particular slide, and this inscriptional numbers and these will mesmerize you. Travancore has always been one of our main headquarters, I would always say, over the centuries.
Nitin, I request you to kindly raise your voice a little, please.
Yep.
And sure. Come to the visuals. People can read through.
Yep. So am I clear now?
Yeah, a little louder.
Yep. So when it comes to the inscriptional count, Travancore, like, which has been always been the capital of Jainism in Karnataka and as well in South India to a great extent, you find over 422 recorded inscriptions, followed by 105 in Hassan district. Means to say Shravanprabha is again a part of Hassan district. Both of them put together add about 527 inscriptions. Then it is followed by Shimoga district, where you find Humcha and other places, Humcha and Kundadris. Then Koppala district. Koppala has 106 inscriptions. One particular thing what you should also look at is, out of 106 inscriptions, 70 of them are Nishadis. When Shravanabelagola, 270 are Nishadis. Nishadis means they are the Sallekana inscriptions. The Sallekana memorial inscriptions, the practice of Sallekana, the documentation. Then moving on to Haveri district, there are about 104 recorded inscriptions. There are a few more which are published, but they haven't, but they are not part of the Shasana Samputa, but however, they have been recorded. One of the recent pieces published by one of my dear friend Ravi Kumar, he's unearthed more than 50 new inscriptions. Then moving on, you see there Gadag, Udupi, that is where you find Karkala. Then Belagavi. We will see about Belagavi today, where you find the oldest available Jain temple that is existing now. Then comes to Mysore, the Kanakagiri and the Mysore Wadayar thing, where you find Kanakagiri with the history of Acharya Pujyapada, who wrote the Shanti Mantras. Then moving on to Mandya district, which is again Kambadhalli, which again is another heritage site, and also Aratipura, where you find what, which is one of the most happening sites, I should say. You will see that in the next session about Aratipura. Make a note of it. Then moving on, Dakshina Kannada district, where you find Moodabidri and Venur and others. Then Chamarajanagar again. And Uttara Kannada district, the coastal part, ma'am just mentioned about Gerusappa, the Gerusappa Salwa rulers and their related inscriptions. Then Tumkur, very close to Bangalore. Then the Kalburgi, the topmost part, the northernmost part of Karnataka. Then the Bangalore, which everyone have heard, the Bangalore city, rural and the main Bangalore urban districts. Coorg, a small district with just three taluks, where you hardly find around 4 to 5 Jain families now, has around 25 inscriptions that are found. That means that is the depth of how Jainism had spread in these regions. Then moving on, you see the numbers over there. I mean, this gives you a quick overview of how rich the Jain heritage is in the different parts of Karnataka, how it has been spread across. There is not even a single district which is an exception. That is how it is. Then moving on, I gave you the numbers. I think given the 2 hours of time, it's not that easy to cover everything. But let's try to have a quick understanding. Look at this, the snapshot of Shravanabelagola. You have 421 recorded inscriptions, starting from 6th century AD to 19th century, of which out of 421, 270 are Sallekana inscriptions. Means to say, Shravanabelagola can also be called as the Sallekana capital of the world, wherein in a single place, you find over 270 Sallekana inscriptions. And it again has details about the royal families. You find the names there. With the I've just given some names of kings who were popular, the Rashtrakutas, Gangas, Kalyana Chalukyas, Hoysalas, the Vijayanagar kings, the Mysore Wadayars, and the Chengalvas, some of the subsidiary kings. Moving on. Like you see, that is how the rich heritage is in terms of the inscriptional references. Now we move on. Look at what are the details it gives about your Acharya Parampara. The 3rd century BC, everyone is aware about the arrival of Acharya Bhadrabahu to Shravanabelagola, which is by the end of the 3rd century BC or the beginning of 2nd century BC. But when did it started getting documented? It was somewhere in 600 AD through a Sanskrit inscription that is found on Shravanabelagola's Chandragiri Hill. Then we move on. If you look at this, this is one of the earliest inscription that gives us a reference of the migration of North Indian Jains to South, and the role played by Acharya Bhadrabahu. And also it indicates...
Nitin, your voice should be louder, Nitin. Okay. We have to strain ourselves to hear.
Got it. And also if you move on, you have the... It also gives the details of the Samadhi of Muni Prabhachandra and others. Moving on, if you look at the other references, the 1st century BC inscriptions of... some references indicate the existence of Acharya Kundukunda, which is at Konakondla, which is definitely now in Andhra Pradesh, which is a Kannada speaking area again. Then you move on, we have references about Acharya Umaswati from 1st century BC. Then moving on, Acharya Pujyapada of Kanakagiri, Devanandi, Samantabhadra, and move on. And here is the last point that you see over here. This is a very interesting point that you see over here. Some of the evidences indicate that Jains existed when the Jaina guru Padaliptacharya arrived from northern India towards the south of Manyakheta. The reason I have particularly chosen this is about Gulbarga district, which is in Sedam taluk of Gulbarga district, which is in the extreme north. You just heard about Shravanabelagola, which is in the south, that is Hassan district. Means to say, right from north to the south or south to the north, Jainism existed everywhere. When a guru arrives from North India in the first century AD, we already had people over there. That is how the Jain thing were there. Then furthermore, what are the details you get from these inscriptions in terms of the ascetic order? We all know Sangh. We always say Sangh or Sangha. You have furthermore categorization as Sangha, then Gana, Gaccha, Anvaya, Bali, and Vibhava. But what are the kind of details that you get over here in these inscriptions? When it comes to the Sanghas, you get Mula Sangha, Nandi Sangha, Dravida Sangha, Yapaniya Sanghas, Sena Sangha, and Naviluru Sangha. These are the ones. These are just some of the names that I have picked up from our inscriptional references. Then the different Ganas, that is the next categorization, which you find, you will see, because the reason I'm mentioning these are all very much important when you try to study the heritage of a place. It's not just about just the temples, the inscript, the idols or the sculptures.
Nitin,
these all contribute.
Nitin, we request you to show us the visuals side by side.
I'll move on.
Yeah.
Next we move on to the Gachas, Anvayas, Bali and Vibhava. These are the further more categorizations of the ascetic order, which you can always refer back to this PPT at a later date. And so this gives you an understanding of how it is. One specific thing I wanted to just tell you, some of these, say for example, look at the under Bali, you find a thing called as Inguleshwara Bali or Hanasoge Bali. Hanasoge is a small village now in Mysore district. It is not even a taluk center. Earlier, it was a chief Jain center where an exclusive sub-categorization of an ascetic order existed. Means to say, that is how Jainism was deep-rooted. You move on. This is particularly the last point, I think, before I move on. This is a very important thing. This is a 5th century inscription, which you will see about this temple's related details. But this is indicates that at a village called Kalavatika, the Kadamba king Murugesha Varma, he made a donation, which comprises of 3 parts. One portion was given to Jinendra Deva. Other was given to Shvetapata Mahasangha. Finally, the other one was given to Nirgrantha Mahashramana Sangha. What does this indicate? This indicates the existence of the third sect of Jainism, that is the Yapaniya Sangha, in addition to Digambara and Shvetambara sects. And this is also a 5th century inscription, which clearly indicates Shvetambara tradition also existed in Karnataka during the 5th century AD. Moving on, look at this particular thing. This is just a quick snapshot of the different royal dynasties that are mentioned in our different inscriptions who have patronaged Jainism over the centuries, right? From the Gangas or the Western Gangas to the Kadambas, Rashtrakutas, and so on. There are about 34 different royal dynasties which have supported Jainism, who have patronized Jainism over the centuries, and that is how Jainism is grown, flourished, and has been flourishing in Karnataka over the centuries. This is how it is. You move on. You would all have heard about the term Basadi. In North India or some other parts, even here, we say Mandir. What is Basadi again? That's again a Jain temple or a Digambar Jain temple. How did it originate? This is something very important that we should all know before we move on. What are the terms that we use for a Basadi or a Jain temple? Arhat Degula, Arhan Talaya, Jina Veshma, Jina Sadama, Jina Bhavana, Jinalaya, Chaitya, Chaityalaya, then Chediya. You move on. One other thing what you have to see over here is Vasahi, the Prakrit term, moved on to transform to Vasati and finally Basadi, that is a place of living for the ascetics. And here are different inscriptional references which clearly indicate the construction of the temples, the basadis, along with that construction of the place of living for the ascetic order who came over there, who traveled across the region. That is how these details have come through. This is something which is very interesting to know how the term basadi or vasadi has originated. This plays a very pivotal role in the origination of the Jain heritage. Next is, I'm just moving on to the visual soon after this. The heritage structures, how are they being based on? You find something like the Trikuta Basadi with three
centers. Again, louder Nitin.
You find
louder Nitin, louder Nitin.
You find Trikuta Basadis, which are the with three sanctorums. Here are some of the names I've just given. Panchakuta Basadi, the Manastambas and the Brahmastambas. And you have the Sahasrakuta idols, the Chaturmukha Basadis, and you have different idols, the Bahubali Chaturmukha idol, Kamotapasarga Parshvanath, Adinath, Padmavati. Based on these things, this is how the entire heritage structures are based around. We move on. Let's move on to the Belagavi or the Belagam district. So I just mentioned over there about the Kadamba King Murugesha Varma. Look at this particular temple. This is the oldest Jain temple that is existent in Karnataka even now. This is called at a place called Halasi, which was called as Palasike earlier, in the Khanapur Taluk of Belagavi or Belagam district. This temple has been, this shot is a bit old shot, maybe the temple is renovated, but this is the oldest existing temple in Karnataka, which was built in 463 and 464 AD. Moving on, here is another temple at a village called Beniwad in Hukkeri Taluk of Belagavi district. This is the Parshvanatha temple, and actual period is not known. However, a 7 lines inscription of the 9th century helps us understand this somewhere belongs to around 9th or 10th century AD. Moving on, here is another temple. This is an interesting thing. From this until the next few slides, you will see this particular thing where you find the first image over here. The kind of seating arrangement that you see for people inside, this kind of arrangement is seen in many of the other two or three other temples that you see later on. This is a temple at Kalloli village in Gokak Taluk of Belagavi district again. It was a popular yatra sthala during the 10th and 11th century AD, and was also called as Siddhana Kallode during the time of Rattas, one of the royal dynasties. It is a temple built during the 1206 AD, and it is also called as Trikuta Pandita Shantinatha Jinalaya. Trikuta temple dedicated to Tirthankara Shantinatha, that is what it means. And we have the idols of Shantinatha, Chandranath, Parshvanath, and Padmavati and Saraswati idols over here. Again, the moment you start hearing about Saraswati, that is where the concept of Jaina Saraswati idols that you will see in the next session. So that is what I meant over here. Here is another thing called as a village called as Vokkunda. Similar to the previous temple, what you saw over there, this is again in Belagavi district of Karnataka. See, if you look at this, I just mentioned about some interesting fact about Chaturmukha or Chaumukha, where you have temples in all four different directions. So this is a temple which is a ruined temple, which was earlier a Chaturmukha temple or a Chaumukha temple. Two of its sites have been ruined, and you find only the two other sites which are there. So in North Karnataka, you don't see much of Chaturmukha temples. This is, I think, one or two Chaturmukha temples that you find in North Karnataka, maybe the only one. You find a lot of four or five Chaturmukha temples in Southern Karnataka. So this is something that needs to be noted about Vokkunda. Moving on, this is a very interesting temple. This is a place called Kagwad in Athani Taluk of Belagavi district. This is a temple of 11th century AD. Look at this particular thing. Look at the visuals over here. This looks as though like any other idols, but there is a lot to infer over here. If you look at this particular idol, the one with the orange one, that is the Kshetrapala Brahma Yaksha. This gives you furthermore heritage of the practice about Kshetrapala and Brahma Yaksha in Karnataka. This is one of them. You look at the one in the middle, the one in the top, the deity is Kaggodaya Yati and Padmavati. Means to say, it is about a Yati who is called as Kaggodaya, on whose name this village is called as Kagavada. And you have Padmavati over there. And the interesting part over here is, this particular temple has been worshipped right now by Shaivites. Point to be noted. Moving on. The one in the second, the one below this in the center, and the one in the right, extreme right. These are, this temple has basements. This, you'll have to go one below, two levels below, one after the other, where you see these temples, the one in the middle, in the second one, that is again the deity of Parshvanatha in the first basement. You'll have to really crawl through like a small kid to get in inside this temple. And then you go further down, is the beautiful temple, deity of Tirthankara Shantinatha and Padmasana. Look at this one small temple, which has got so much of treasure hidden inside it. This is one of the uniqueness. This is one small example of how vastly you find the Jain temples in Karnataka, about the unique traditions. Each and every temple, each and every slide you see over there vary from each other. Move on. This is something like Belagam ka shaan hai. This is like Belagavi, or the district center of Belagam. This is, I would say, this is one of the proud things over there, which is also called as the Kila Basadi or the Kamal Basadi, which is built in the later Chalukya style, built in 1204 by Bichirja, a minister of Kartavirya of Ratta dynasty. Two of its pillars have Kannada inscriptions in Nagari scripts, and other details are given over there. And the shikaras over here, and the people who are particularly experts in this shikaras, there are experts who specialize in that. You can understand over here, it is a Kadamba Nagara shikara. And you see this particular thing over here again. When you look at the temple's entrance, you saw two other temples over there, the one at Vakunda and the one at Kalloli. Over there, I told you, you find a similar kind of an arrangement. Look at this particular thing. I don't know whether my slider is, you are able to see my mouse over here at the entrance around this. The person can always sit around there inside. That is how the seating arrangements are made. And again, this is the carvings over there. One of the samples over here, how the carvings are there surrounding the temple, the rich carvings that you see over there. And look at this, how beautifully it looks during night. This is under the ASI. And that is how they have the light arrangement, no less than any of the palaces. That's how nicely our Jain temples look. That is how nicely they have been made in those days. Moving on, this particular temple is again another story of itself. This place is called as Ammanagi, and inscriptional evidences indicate that it was also called as Ammanikad in the inscriptions. And this has an inscription of 1257 AD, and this is the Parshvanatha temple with the shikara in the Kadamba Nagara style again. You also see a Chavvis Tirthankara idol, which is made out of greenstone. This entire temple was covered in mud. It was found when some other work was being taken up, and the entire mud was removed. That is how Ammanagi is all about. Then Gokak. Here is another temple at Gokak. Near Gokak, there is another temple, another place called Konnur, which was again a Jain center. We could not manage to get the images, so I did not venture to have the images of Konnur. This is a temple of Suparshvanatha Tirthankar. The temples were not just the places of worship. Saraswati ka upasana bhi hota tha. Ho raha tha. Abhi bhi chalta rehta hai. But this particular temple, lot of Jain kavis, they spend their time over here. They have done a lot of swadhyaya here. Example, Shantikirti Muni wrote the Shodasha Bhavana Charitre. You have also other Puranas, the Adishwara Purana, Shantishwara Purana, and the Parshvanatha Puranas have been written in this particular temple.
Nitin, it's 9 o'clock. Just a reminder, okay?
Sure.
You have a lot of things to show, so you need not read. We'll read it.
I'll move fast. Yeah. Then here is another temple at Ainapur. There are two temples at Ainapur over here. And one of them is about Adinatha and other one is about Parshvanatha. And both of them have a Mukha Mantapa and a Navaranga and the standard structures. But one particular thing is about the Sahasrakuta. I mentioned about Sahasrakuta earlier. In the next session, you will see a lot of Sahasrakutas moving forward. This is one of such Sahasrakuta idols that you see over here at Ainapur. So the two temples, the Adinatha temple, the Parshvanatha temple, and the Sahasrakuta idol at Ainapur are the important things over here. Moving on, we will move on to Bagalkote district. You will cherish the visuals over here. Look at this, the Aihode Jaina caves. Look at the caves, the entrance over here. These are all the Badami Chalukyan caves of 6th and 7th century AD. It has a veranda as soon as you enter. On either sides, you have two deities. One is of Tirthankara Parshvanatha and Bhagavan Bahubali. And look at the carvings over there. These were all the initial style of carvings that were there, that were made on those days, which have evolved over a period of time. And as you see over here, the one in the second row below, that is where you see the visuals in the top, the rich carvings that were there those days during the end of 6th century AD. And also in the one of the sanctum sanctorums, you find the Tirthankar Mahavir and the related women around with and other deities around there. Moving on. So this is what it is about the Aihode Jaina caves. Then Aihode is again another temple you find over there, another temple of 634 AD called as the Meghuti temple. This is a temple that is located above a hill called as the Meghuti hill. It is a two-storied north-facing temple dedicated to Tirthankar Mahavir. This is when someone tries to understand the development of Chalukyan architecture. This is one of the best examples. This temple has a Pradakshinapatha, that is within the temple itself structure, you have people to move around. And one other thing is, like I mentioned, it has a two-story, you can see that in the top. And the deity over here, it's not very intricately carved, similar to the previous one, what we saw over here. You find a similar kind of a carving over here. And then one another very important part of this particular temple is the Aihode Prashasti inscription or Aihode Prashasti Shasana, which anyone who comes to Aihode would not want to miss this. It is on the either side of this particular temple. It is called as Ravikirti's inscription of 634 AD. It is a poem in a, with a Sanskrit text. This is one. Then moving on, at the Badami caves. Who haven't heard about Badami, the World Heritage Sites? The Badami caves are again in the Bagalkote district. There are seven. And here, there are a row of four different caves in four different steps as you go through different stories in a building. And this is in the fourth story called as the Meghana Basadi, the topmost story. This is dedicated to Jainism. The other two you find dedicated to Hinduism. And over here, it's a very interesting structure. I mean, I will spend some time over here to explain over here. You heard about me speaking about Sallekana inscriptions at Shravanabelagola. You heard me speaking about Sallekana inscriptions at Koppada. And here is one more. Here is the Sallekana memorial you see over here. The one with a lady called bowing down to the Tirthankara called as Jakkave, a Jaina householder. Then soon after that, you find Bahubali and Parshvanatha exactly opposite to each other. And again over here, another important thing that you should be looking at over here is the style of carving of the Bahubali idol and the Parshvanatha idols. Particularly the Parshvanatha idol, this is again a Kamatopa Sarga Parshvanatha. You find the Padmavati holding the umbrella above Tirthankara's head, and you find Kamata bowing down, and you find, if you closely observe over there with a detailed photograph, you will see Kamata Supasargas again over there. And moving on, you will also see further inside, you find Chavis Tirthankara, the Chobisi, what we call, that were there, that have been carved over there. Next, this is another temple. This is a pretty interesting temple in terms of its name. It is a Jaina Basadi called as the Jaina Narayana Basadi. And this is at again Pattadkal. This is of 9th century AD during the time of Rashtrakuta King Krishna II. Again, this is a two-story temple, similar to what you saw over there in Aihole. Not too many two-story temples are seen in Karnataka, and these two are a couple of them. Again, like I mentioned with the previous temple at Aihole, this is the Garbhagriha, Pradakshinapatha, Antarala, Mantapa, and the Mukhamantapas. And also, if you look at this particular thing on your right, extreme right of the temple, you see for water passage, they have clearly installed pranalas to drain the water from the roof. Moving on, this is a very interesting place, friends. This is called as Teradala. Teraha is what? 13 in Hindi. This village is a combination of 13 different villages, hence it is called as Teradala. It was a chief Jaina center, and it has three different Devanagari inscriptions over there. And this is a temple that was built in 1123 AD during the period of Kakatavirya III. And this was again built by a person called Gonka, who was a subsidiary of Saudatti Rattas, one of the other royal families. That is why I mentioned about the names that we might come across at the beginning of the session. And one important thing over here is the kings over here, they used to support the Jaina ascetics to a great extent. And hence, a lot of munis used to stay at Teradala and undertake Sallekana. So that is again, this is at a completely interiors of Karnataka and Bagalkote district, not a very well-known place, but it was once a chief center for the Jaina munis to practice Sallekana and other Jaina rituals. Moving on, we will move on to Bidar district. In the extreme topmost part of Karnataka. I'm just covering two to three temples over here because of the time gap. Friends, we have seen Jainism has gone with the tide. It has gone with the people. Jina Dharma has become a Jana Dharma. Jana, that is the people. It is the people's religion. And here is another example of a temple with a unique structure with an influence of Mughal architecture. It is a 14th century temple dedicated to Tirthankar Shantinatha. So look at this particular thing, the kind of architecture that it has. It has about the Mughal architecture, it has an influence of the Mughal architecture, but inside structure is about Tirthankar Shantinatha. Moving on, Kamtana Parshvanath. This is a pretty interesting idol, friends. This is the Parshvanath Tirthankar idol that was there in the basement for quite some centuries together. It is about 1100 years old. This idol was built, brought up to the ground floor from the basement at the behest of a Muni in 1989, very recently, about 30 years back, by a Muni called Shrutakirti ji. And the temple has been reworked, reconstructed with mirror work. A lot of people from northern part of Karnataka and Andhra and Maharashtra, they flocked to this particular place. At Kamtana, there are hardly any Jain families over there, but still this has been preserved very nicely. Then we move on. Kalburgi or the Gulbarga district. I spoke about Panchakuta Basadi. Panchakuta, that is about five different sanctum sanctorums or five Garbhagrihas. This is the Panchakuta Basadi at Harsur, which is dedicated to Tirthankar Parshvanath. Dedicated in the 11th century AD. This is a combination of Trikuta, that is the main temple, what you see over there in the topmost image. Within that, in front of that, you find the two other temples. Hence, it is called as the Panchakuta Basadi. And in the main sanctum sanctorum, the Parshvanath idol that you see over here, to see in the normal with your photographs, it may not see very huge. It's 8 feet 6 inches high Parshvanath Tirthankar in Padmasana. Just imagine how magnanimous it might be. Then in the other two sanctum sanctorums, Garbhagrihas, you have Vignahara Parshvanath and Adinath idols. And it has a very unique ancient idol of Dharanendra and Padmavati. You see over here, this is about Dharanendra and Padmavati. In the middle, you see Parshvanatha. So this is probably, I haven't seen any such deities, at least in Karnataka or even in other parts, which is as ancient as this with such a unique carving. Means to say that worship of Dharanendra and Padmavati, that is the Yaksha and Yakshi, how it is also been closely knitted to the religion over the centuries. This is one of the examples. And even in the one below the first row, first column rather, you see another two deities. These are the deities in front of the main sanctum sanctorum. These are of Chobisi again, which are 5 feet high again, with the idols of Tirthankar Adinath and Mahavir in the center. This is another example of the rich tradition over here in the Kalburgi district. Moving on, there are two temples at Hunsi Hadagali, another village over there. And one is about the Shantinatha Trikuta temple, which is not in a great state. There's another temple of Parshvanatha Dharanendra and Padmavati, which is in a good condition. Moving on, here is another temple at a village called Atnur in Kalburgi or Gulbarga district. It is an ancient temple of Tirthankar Chandranath. If you see the idols over there, the kind of chauri bearers that have been engraved over there, the entire carvings, you can see that. So that is, this is again another example of the carvings and the antiquity of the Jain heritage, and also Atnur, a village, a remote village, having a richly carved structures over there. Then we move on to the last two or three slides. I mean, I went a bit fast today, mainly to make sure we have ample room for Q&A and other things. This is Bijapur, erstwhile Bijapur, now called as the Vijayapura. This is a Sahasrafani Parshvanatha temple, that is, which has 1008 hooves of Tirthankar Parshvanath, an idol that was got during 1910s, which was hidden inside underground when it was discovered during the land excavation work of a person's house. This is the 11th and 12th century temple, idol rather. But one particular interesting thing is, you see the funny or the sarpa in the topmost part. The moment you do the abhisheka over there, let's say you're doing a kshira abhisheka or the abhisheka through milk, the moment it is put up over there, it flows through the entire structure over there and finally comes onto the Tirthankara Bhagavan. That is, you can just imagine how intricately would that have been carved, so that right from the topmost funny, the topmost serpent thing, it comes on the Tirthankar head going through the entire structure. That is how, this is another example of the workmanship and the rich Jain heritage in Karnataka. And this is again found in the Dargah area. The temple has been constructed in the place where it was found. That is where you find this Padachinna. That is where the idol was found underneath. Probably it was just dug and submerged underneath to avoid any attack on the idol. Moving on, here is another idol, another temple called as Parshvanatha temple at Baba Nagar. This is the Parshvanatha idol that you see over here, which in fact, like, one important thing is, this particular idol changes its colors 3 times a day. And I do have photographs. I mean, I did not happen to have it here. It changes its colors all throughout the day in 3 times. And again, this is a very ancient idol that was again found underneath. This is a 12th century AD idol. Again, you see over here another orange image of a Brahma Iksha over there, Kshetrapala Brahma Deva. Again, the concept of how the religion evolved over the centuries, how people even to this day do different kind of rituals. That is another example. Moving on, I mean, I think I'm done with my presentation for today. Today, like say, to tell you before we move on to any further questions and answers, I mean, my main intent over here was to give a basic understanding and the depth of the inscriptions, the royal patronage, the Muni Dharma, the Parampara, how the Basadi concept evolved, the construction of different structures within the temple as a part of the temple for the Munis or the Bhatta Rakas to stay over there, all those heritage, that tradition that has been evolved in Karnataka over the centuries. That is where I wanted to lay the foundation. Then cover around 5 to 6 districts of Karnataka, which gives you a quite a bit understanding of how deeply Jainism is rooted in different parts of Karnataka, at least in the northern part, what we have done now. In the next session, we will go with the rest of the other structures in Karnataka. And over to you, ma'am, for the next proceedings.
Nitin, can you quickly tell people about Jerusalem?
Yes. That's a good one, madam. Gerusoppe, the Gerusoppe is known after the Salava rulers of Gerusoppe, who were the subsidiaries under the Vijayanagara kings, who existed somewhere during the 14th century to 14th and 15th century. And Gerusoppe has a Chaturmukha Basadi, which you will get to see at a later date in my next session. And it is one of the very unique Chaturmukha Basadis that you find in Karnataka. And one interesting thing over here, friends, Gerusoppe was ruled by a woman called as Rani Chennabhaira Devi for over 45 to 50 years. Probably this is a record in world history or in Indian history. Just imagine a lady, a woman ruler who is ruled for more than 45 to 50 years. There is the reason I'm giving you a range is because there's quite a bit of discussion and non-agreement in terms of the timelines. However, 45 plus years is somewhere many of us agree upon. And one other important thing was, there are some travelogues that are available from a couple of foreign travelers, from one of the foreign travelers, where he explains that there were so many ports across the entire port of Karnataka, that is starting from from Goa until the Mangalore and Udupi, including Gerusoppa. Gerusoppa is again part of the coastal belt, that is the Uttara Kannada district. This is just adjacent to Honavara, which is again a port town. There were a lot of small ports. One of the references indicate that there were about 72 ports that were managed by Rani Chennabhaira Devi or the Saluva kings. And later on, she fought against the Portuguese. How did it find its debacle is something very interesting. I think it's good, madam, you just asked me to speak about it. We have a couple of minutes. I'll quickly say, how did it find its debacle? And when you see the visuals next time, you will be able to correlate with what I say now. She happened to marry, after Rani Chennabhaira Devi, there was her successor, the next woman ruler who was over there. She happened to marry one of the Sainikas over there, who was Dandanayakas or the generals, and he becomes a king. And she, with all the trust, gives him all the control, and he goes to the Keladi rulers and sabotages his own wife. And the Keladi rulers wage a war against the Gerusoppe queen. The Gerusoppe queen went to the Portuguese. All those while Portuguese and all had a very rich trade relationship with the kings and queens of Gerusoppe. And then what happens? She goes to the Portuguese. They said, we used to ask you to pay the tax and all, you denied. Now you need our help. No, we will not support you. That is what the Portuguese said those days. Then she came back. She tried to wage the war against the Keladi rulers. Then at the last minute, nth minute, Portuguese realized their mistake. They come back to the rescue of the queen. However, the time had already flashed out. They were completely attacked. The Gerusoppe city, this is what you see right now. Around 6 kilometers inside the city over there, from the main road, from the national highway over there, the Honavara Joke Falls National Highway or the Batkal National Highway, from the main road, you go 6 kilometers inside. It's completely in the middle of thick forest. I have trekked through the thing over there. It's another 9 kilometer trek upstream over there, which is called as a fort called as Kanuru Kote, which is spread over an area of around 350 acres, where trekking within the fort itself took around another 7 to 9 kilometers. Again, coming back is another 9. It is like a mini Samet Shikharji Yatra. If you go up the thing, that was again under the control of the Gerusoppe queen, kings and queens. What happens? Finally, the Gerusoppe queen was defeated. She was imprisoned with all the due respects. Her husband was hanged to death. The Keladi ruler said, when you sabotaged your own wife, what is the proof that you would not sabotage us? Finally, you know what Keladi rulers did? This is something that we should really, I mean, that is very painstaking thing to hear, wherein the Keladi ruler said, it's because of this rich city of Gerasoppe with so many temples and such a rich heritage and everything that we had this war. No one else should come and wage a war against me. And the Keladi ruler ordered for the demolition and ravaging of the city. That is when the entire the sainikas or their the senadhipatis, everyone, they ravaged the city, they destroyed the city, they destroyed the Jain temples, they burned the city. You go to Gerasoppe even now, you come with me, I'll show you. You can find traces of small burnt things of iron things you see, some powders you see, small bubbles you see. That is what is Gerasoppe now. You will not believe, friends. Another important thing is Gerasoppe area is, I told you, is in the middle of the forest. It is spread over an area of 700 acres that is under the ASI. If even a small construction has to happen at Gerasoppe, you have to take the permissions of the Archaeological Survey of India, your Aranya Ilaka or the Forest Department of Karnataka, the PWD department and the district administration, and only then any work has to happen there. We have made a lot of attempts over there. Earlier, you were unable to even go there normally. You were supposed to go only through a boat. Very recently, the trust over there, and I've been closely working with the trust over there, we were able to convince the government of Karnataka through the local MLA funds. We were able to have the roads made. Now even the normal buses go over there. But that is the rich tradition of Gerasoppe. You will see about the idols and the temple over there in the next successive slides. I think this gives quite a bit of information. Thank you, madam, for particularly raising the issue about Gerasoppe. I think this is a pretty interesting fact everyone should know about one of the things. Just imagine, friends, 72 ports. Even in India, if you count now, I don't know what is the total count of ports that you have in India under the Government of India records. Those days, she had 72 ports, small and big ports. Just imagine the rich hold, rich tradition, the hold of Jains or the administration of the region. Over to you, madam.
Yes, yes, Nitin. Thank you so much and congratulations and so much of hard work you've put in. We really appreciate the work that you have done on the field and for the presentation, Nitin. Thank you so much for giving a head start to this whole series. And we look forward to your second presentation. I cannot really thank you enough. And we will please, we request you to kindly share this PPT with everybody. And you have documented things so beautifully. And this need to be told to the Government of India. I will request Nirmal Kumarji Sethi to please give Nitin a chance and please help us to show all these videos and all these inscriptions on our national channels for people to rise up and see the rich heritage that is spread in different states of India. This is just a beginning and it's a long journey. So Nirmal Kumarji, this presentation is to strengthen your hands to do more work, and Nitin, to strengthen you to do more work, the Department of Genealogy and the departments, both the departments and the foundation with you. And thank you so much again. So we'll have the three questions now. The audience, now it is your time. You will have to raise your hand. Ravichandran sir will have to watch who raises the hand. Only they will be given a chance. So from the presentation made by Nitin, we will ask the questions. The first one is, how many inscriptions did Nitin talk about? How many inscriptions did Nitin talk about in his presentations? Presentation, and which university has documented those inscriptions? I have two questions in one question. Anybody has the answer? Anybody has the answer? Can raise your hand.
I can unmute and tell also.
Yes, you can unmute yourself. The host has unmuted all of you. But please do not unmute yourself if you are not talking.
I'm
tell your name. Please tell your name and tell the answer.
I am Kishan Chand Jotia.
Yes, Kishan Chand sir.
Yes. Kannada University Hampi. And Kannada University Hampi has recorded it. And 2,000 inscriptions have been mentioned.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Kishan Chand sir. Allowed applause for him. Kannada University and 2,000 out of 2,000 inscriptions, 1,800 inscriptions have documented by them. Thank you, Kishan Chand sir. The second question is, what is the meaning of Vasahi or Basadi? What is the meaning of Vasahi or Basadi given by Nitin in his presentation?
Jinalaya.
Temple.
Amita here.
Yes, Amita.
Jinalaya, Vasati, Basadi, everything, Chetalaya, Chetya. So many meanings were given.
So Vasadi means the place of stay. The place of stay for the Munis. Okay, thank you. Nitin in his presentation told about some Sangha, names of some Sangha. Can you identify two names? Two names of two Sanghas. Not Kishan Chacha, somebody else.
I am Shanta, Moola Sangha, Dravida Sangha.
Yes, Shanta madam. Moola Sangha, Dravida Sangha. Okay, that's good. Three questions we have done. Can you tell the names of five dynasties that have patronized Jainism in Karnataka? Five dynasties that have patronized Jainism.
Hoysalas, Chalukyas.
Your name, please. You have to tell your name.
Gangas.
Kamal Jain.
Okay.
I am Shanta from Tindivanam. Shanta. Yes. Hoysalas, Rashtrakutas, Hoysalas, Gangas.
Yes, so she's told us about three, and Shanta Tatia, she has done her research in the Department of Jainology and Shaivism on the Jaina vestiges in Vilipuram district. Thank you, Shanta madam. Okay, can you tell me the name of the temple where you have the place where you have the Sahasra Phana Parshvanath temple? The name of the place. Those who have already answered should not talk. We request the others to participate. The name of the place where the Sahasra Phana temple was there of Parshvanatha. If you have closely observed the PowerPoint, you will be able to recall. So much of efforts has gone in to put this PPT. We appreciate your presence.
Madam Ramkumar, Vijayapura, madam.
Yes, Ramkumar sir. Ramkumar student from the Department of Jainology. Thank you, Ramkumar sir. Yes, last question. The name of the queen. Who ruled Jerusalem? The name of the queen who ruled Jerusalem.
Rani Channa Bhairava Devi, madam.
Again, Ramkumar sir, you should not be talking. Ravichandran sir, please mute everybody. Those who want to talk can alone unmute themselves. Only one person.
Let them raise the hand, I will unmute.
Nobody is raising the hand. Everybody is excited to give the answer. Okay, fine, no problem. So Ramkumar sir has already given the answer, Channa Bhaira Devi. There are so many questions that I have written, and next presentation will be on Shravan Belgola, Jerusape, and all these things Nitin will be showing on the last day. And yes, Nitin, you want to respond?
The next one will be a visual treat. Take it from me. This was a basic foundational treatment of Jain heritage in Karnataka, and then moving on to the visuals. Next one will be a visual treat, because whatever you have read over here, studied over here, all of them will find those reference across in the coming presentation.
Yeah. Thank you, Nitin. We look forward for more visuals from all the presenters. The descriptive part, I think the people can read, the researchers can read, but the people are generally interested in the visuals.
Right.
So I request all the other speakers to keep this thing in mind. And thank you, Nitin. Now we'll have the announcement. And can I have Nirmal sir's response in 1 minute? It is time for us to close the meeting. We'll promise that we'll close in good time. The announcement is that tomorrow, Dr. Shanti Swarup Sinhaji will be taking us to Devgarh, where you will see 70 hairstyles of Tirthankar Bhagwan. Okay, in Uttar Pradesh. So we'll be traveling from Karnataka to Uttar Pradesh, and day after tomorrow we'll be traveling to Madhya Pradesh. and after that to Tamil Nadu, Orissa, West Bengal, and back to Karnataka. So, Sethi sir, can I have your response just in 1 minute? Do you have anything to say, sir?
No, very good. Very good information has been given by Nitin. We thank him very much. And next meeting, he will give more things. But he has studied the thing properly and he has given, we must thank him very much.
Yes, sir.
And thank I you. Also thank you, Peer Darshana ji. Aapko bhi bahut bahut dhanyavaad deta hun. Kyunki aapne bahut achhi tarah se organize kiya is session ko. To bahut hi achha laga hame. Bahut achha laga. Aapne bahut hi achha organize kiya hai. Aur aapko bahut bahut dhanyavaad deta hun. Many, many thanks to you.
Aap jo kaam kar rahe hain uske samne to hum bachche hain, sir. आपके ये शब्द हमें बहुत, आपका ये आशीर्वचन हमें बहुत संबल देगा. बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद, बहुत बहुत आभार. एंड नाउ वी कम टू द शुद्धातम सॉन्ग मेरा धाम. एंड देन आई वुड लाइक टू थैंक निर्मल कुमार सर, नितिन सर, शांति स्वरूप सिन्हा जी, किशन चंसा, शोभा वर्तमान मैडम, एंड ऑल द ऑडियंस मेंबर्स हु हैव जॉइंड अस. गीता, सॉरी, मित्तल इज देयर विद अस. And Shripal ji is there from USA. All the staff and students who have helped me to put this across. I'm thankful to all the 5 organizations who have given us a chance. And of course, we are looking forward for more presentations. Thank you all. Thank you so much. And now we have the Shuddhatam song, which talks about the philosophy for which the Jain temples stand, the Jain inscriptions stand. So it is a celebration of spirituality, the divinity, the humanity that is in all of us, which is the need of the hour. So with this song, we would like to devote ourselves to the spirit of the Jinas, and we all work from violence to non-violence, from untruth to truth, from possession to non-possession, and from perversion to spirituality, that is enlightenment. So over to Ravichandran sir, and thank you all. After this song, the meeting ends, and we look forward to having you all tomorrow with us. Over to Ravichandran.
Mera dham Shuddhatam hai mera naam, Matra janana mera kaam, Mukti puri hai mera dham, Milta jahan poorn vishram. Shuddhatam hai mera naam, Matra janana mera kaam, Mukti puri hai mera dham, Milta jahan poorn vishram. Jahan bhook ka naam nahi hai, Jahan pyaas ka kaam nahi hai, Khaansi aur zukham nahi hai, Aadhi vyadhi ka naam nahi hai. सत शिव सुंदर मेरा धाम, शुद्धातम है मेरा नाम, मात्र जानना मेरा काम, शुद्धातम है मेरा नाम. स्वयं पर भेद विज्ञान करेंगे, निज आत्म का ध्यान करेंगे, राग द्वेष का त्याग करेंगे, चिदानंद रस पान करेंगे. सब सुखदाता मेरा धाम, शुद्धातम है मेरा नाम, मात्र जानना मेरा काम, मुक्तिपुरी है मेरा धाम, मिलता जहां पूर्ण विश्राम. जय जिनेंद्र.
यस, you are all free to interact with the scholar, anybody who wants to interact. Otherwise, the meeting has ended. Thank you all. Anybody who has a question for the presenter, you can ask him now. Nitin, people are asking for the presentation, whether it will be available to them so that they can see it again, read it again.
Yes, I'll make some edits to that, add in a bit more information onto that, and then it will be shared once both the presentations are done.
So you all can log on to Nitin's website, Jain Heritage Centers, beautiful website, and on his Facebook page you can look at all the details. Thank you all. anybody else who has any question for the presenter, you can interact with him.
Good evening, Dr. Priyadarshana. This is Shobha here.
Yes, Shobha madam. Nitin sir, this is Wing Commander Abhinandan's mother, Dr. Shobha Vartaman.
Hello, madam. Jai Jinendra.
Jai Jinendra, it was a wonderful presentation, Nitin, and to see that how much of effort you have put into the research and the photographs as well. Thank you. My question to you is, out of these 72 ports, what trade happened in those ports? Is it just timber and pepper, or did they have that much timber and pepper to trade through these 72 ports?
Even I am very curious even to this day, but I think definitely the spices were the main things, is what I feel. And at the same time, in exchange to that, we have even seen, it's not just them, even the Arabs used to come down after the Portuguese as well. We have also seen them bringing in the horses and others from those countries onto
Nitin,
here.
Nitin, louder, Nitin.
Yep. So along with the spices, we have spices were definitely the main ones, madam. Along with that, there were also instances wherein we have seen details about the horse trading being happening from those countries being brought over here and sold to the Indian kings. Well, that has happened.
So it's a big trading center as well. Yes. Do we have any documentation on who all came to trade in those ports? Because 72 is a large amount of trade must have happened.
That's right. So many of them were small ones, and there are large ones as well. Like, in fact, like, say, very close to Girsoppa, you have the city Honnavara. And it's about 40 kilometers or 45 kilometers ahead. On the outskirts of Honnavara, you find a small island over there. And we Jains, we have called it as, with the locals, there's a Jain person over there adjacent to that. We call it as the Chenna Bairadevi Island. Means to say that was the end of the port those days. Now it has become an island over there, adjacent to Girsoppa. Mm-hmm. And over here, there, nobody has gone there except a couple of the locals. They say there might be some ruins of Jain temples. One of them, they have seen the Brahma Yaksha idol over there. The Kshetrapala Brahma Yaksha idols over there is what I've heard from one of the local priests who has gone to that idol, that island rather. So these kind of things, there are a lot of research that has to happen. One thing I would like to add here, looking at the vastness over there, I have named it. I mean, rather many of the media people have reused it. I'm really happy they have reused it. I would usually call Girsoppa as the Jaina Harappa, given the entire vastness of this particular city. There's as the Harappa thing keeps on happening, likewise, Girsoppa, a lot of research is yet to happen. And you will also see one very interesting thing, research I did last year in the presentation about Girsoppa, a very unique idol with an inscription that was found sometime last year. I mean, it was found in the middle of the forest. We did a research and we unearthed we reinterpreted the inscription, and it has been published in the Shasana Samputa by Hampi University.
And what language are these inscriptions?
Kannada.
Kannada.
Nadu Kannada, that is Middle Kannada.
Thank you very much and wonderful job.
Question from Harita Lakshmi.
Thank you, Shobhaji, for your response.
Next question from Harita Lakshmi.
Yes, Harita Lakshmi.
Harita Lakshmi.
Harita Lakshmi, please ask your question. Okay. We can stop the live.
She's not available, ma'am. Recording. Next.
Ma'am, one minute. Yes, Kanaka Das, sir, has unmuted. Sir, you have gotten.
Yes, Kanaka, sir.
Mr. Nitin, it was an excellent presentation. I want one thing to be enlightened. We had a very problem in the 6th and 7th century by Bhakti movement. The Saivites actually driven the Jains out from Pandyan country. Right. Did Karnataka Jainism met any such problem there?
Yes, sir. You will see that in the next presentation, sir. You will see how the massacre had happened. We have an inscriptional reference and rather a sculptural reference with an inscription around how it had happened in a rather central part of Karnataka, or the northern part, I would say, beginning of northern part. You will see that over there in my next presentation. It is a place called as Abbalur.
period. Which period?
11th century, sir.
Oh, we met in earlier.
Yes, sir.
6th and 7th
Yes, sir.
Okay, okay.
Kanaka Jidda, sir. The yes, Bhakti movement period is the 14th to the 17th century, you know, in North India.
No, oh, we at 6th and 7th, Tamil Nadu.
South India.
Tamil Nadu.
Okay, Tamil Nadu. The Shaivite and the Vaishnavites, the Alwars, the Nayanars and all that.
Mostly Shaivites.
Temples what you saw today and a few others as well, many of them the idols were submerged, I mean they were kept inside the ground and all because of avoiding these kind of attacks as well. And either, so that is what you have seen couple of them, you will see more, at least one of them very evidently, I'll spend separate 2 minutes on that explaining how the sculpture is all about. To understand what was the impact.
Yes, yes. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Nitin, I had a question I'll ask you later. You had that the fund, the donation was given to Jinendra Deva, then to the Mahasangha and the Nirgrantha Mahasangha.
Right.
So what do these three terms indicate? Jinendra Deva means it could be the Deva Dravya, no?
Deva Dravya or in some of the epigraphies, they conclude that to be the Digambara sect. And okay. Pata, they consider it to be Shvetambara, and other one they consider it to be the Yapaniya.
Okay, okay. Thank you. Thank you, Nitin. Anybody else has any question for Nitin? So, Nitin, we look forward for more visuals.
You will see that, madam. You'll
definitely see the next visuals.
Yeah. In Tamil Nadu, such a donation to Jaina establishment is called Pallichandam. Mm-hmm. The name Pallichandam.
It is here, the, yes, there are different terminologies we are used. One of like the Dana Shasanas, the donation inscriptions are called as Dati Shasanas here, sir.
I see, yes.
So, Nitin, thank you again for all the efforts. Thank you, audience members. Thank you, everybody. We end the meeting over here and look forward to seeing you all tomorrow. Thank you all. Thank you, Nitin.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you very much.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.